is the 2nd of January 2016, where you're watching Weekly Report with me, Brenda Zederadido, of course, here at Ebro Africa TV. This is the first edition of the Weekly Report in the year 2016, where we shall be telling you about stories that made it to the headlines in Kenya and, of course, across the African globe. But first, let's take a look at the highlights.
Central African Republic presidential poll winner to be announced in 15 days. Guinea declared free of Ebola after more than 2,500 people died from the virus. Burundi's President Pierre Nkurunziza says he will fight against any peacekeepers sent into the country by the AU. Kenyan public primary school performed poorly compared to their private counterparts in the 2015 KCPE.
Security has been beefed up in Central African Republic as vote counting started on Thursday after a first successful democratic elections held on Wednesday. The voting exercise was, however, marred with a few irregularities and a rerun for National Assembly in some areas due to ballots failing to arrive.
The elections that had repeatedly been postponed due to violence and irregularities went on successfully. About 30 candidates are competing in the presidential election, which is a major milestone in the transition to democracy.
Voting went well since this morning, apart from a fraud attempt which happened at around 14:45, when a voter tried to cast his ballot using a photocard meant for a woman, which did not belong to him. When we stopped him, asked the name of his father, he couldn't tell us. The name of his mother, he couldn't tell us either. He started not to make any sense when he was talking. After a while, he confessed and told us one of his big brothers sent him.
Election observers reported few irregularities after polls closed. According to African Union election observers, there were delays in some polling areas since some candidates had been left out on ballot papers.
Le premier, c'est que ce qui avait fait causer le retard du scrutin.
One of the first things we found was the cause of the polling delays. One of the legislative election candidates was forgotten on the ballot paper, which caused a little bit of a delay. We spoke to the National Authority for Elections and they told us to start the vote, but they will take the findings into account.
Earlier, long queues were observed at polling stations in Bangui and in the mainly PK5 neighborhood. The voting exercise took place under tight security from United Nations peacekeepers, who positioned armored personnel carriers at voting stations to avoid a repeat of violent clashes seen during a recent referendum on the new constitution. Some voters had their voting cards but did not have their names on the voting list, AU observers said.
We also found that some voters had their voting cards but did not have their names on the electoral list. But apart from these findings, no irregularities have been observed.
The election authority said it will rerun voting for the National Assembly in some areas where ballot papers failed to arrive. Provisional results will be announced in the following days, and the Constitutional Court must give final results 15 days after polling day.
Let's cross over to Burundi, where Burundi's President Pierre Nkurunziza has said that Burundians would fight against any peacekeepers sent into the country by the African Union. Now, Nkurunziza was responding to the AU's plan to deal with an escalating political crisis in Burundi.
The African Union said this month it was ready to send 5,000 peacekeepers to Burundi to protect civilians caught up in months of violence. That may never happen. And if the AU goes ahead and invokes, for the first time, powers to intervene in a member state against its will, Burundi President Pierre Nkurunziza said he will repulse the peacekeepers.
Burundi is a sovereign state, and everyone has to respect Burundi's borders. The United Nations Security Council has made decisions in the past. We adhere to, but we do not accept any forces coming here. In case they violate our sovereignty and our borders, every Burundian will rise up and fight them, because our country will be under attack. We will protect ourselves.
Other government officials have already said any peacekeepers arriving without Burundi's permission would violate its sovereignty. Nkurunziza also reiterated the government's position that any opposition members who had taken part in a failed coup in May should be barred from participating in peace talks. The talks kicked off this week in Kampala, Uganda. The talks brokered by the East African Community Regional Bloc were expected to reconvene in Tanzania next month, but it remains unclear if Burundi's government will participate if they do not agree on which individuals represent the opposition. More than 400 people have been killed and 220,000 have fled to neighboring countries since the crisis erupted in April, triggered by Nkurunziza's bid for a third term. Continued clashes and targeted assassinations in Bujumbura have unsettled a region where memories of the 1994 genocide in neighboring Rwanda are still raw. In his comments on Wednesday, Nkurunziza also appeared to praise Rwandan President Paul Kagame, who Burundi has accused of supporting rebel groups' efforts to recruit Burundian refugees and of interfering in Burundi's affairs. Kagame, however, denies this.
Special Representative of the United Nations Secretary General for Somali, Nicholas Kay, has officially left Somalia, bringing to an end a diplomatic stint spanning more than 2 years in the country. Kay has been in the war-raged country since 2013.
A short send-off ceremony was held at the Aden Abdullah Airport for the UN representative who has worked for a better Somalia since his arrival in Mogadishu in June 2013. In his speech, the Somali Minister of Foreign Affairs, Abdusalam Hadli Omar, described Nicholas Kay as a true friend of the Somali people whose efforts have left an indelible mark in the history of the country.
The UN mission in Somalia is crucial to Somalia's future, and during his tenure as a leader, Nick Kay worked with the government of the Republic of Somalia to help shape a new vision for better Somalia and its people.
Ambassador Kay told the gathering he was leaving Somalia with fond memories and full of optimism about the future of the country.
Now we can take a few moments for both of your team.
Today I think is also a happy and a positive day as well. Happy for me, first because I'm going home and I'm going back to my family. Happy for me also because, as the minister says, I think we can truly see that in Somalia there is an unstoppable momentum now to peace, to stability and prosperity and democracy, and that unstoppable momentum was not here 3 years ago. It is here now.
Kay stressed he will forever remember his stay in Somalia and its people's resilience to make Somalia a better country.
South Sudan President Salva Kiir, newly appointed governors for 28 states have been sworn in. The swearing-in ceremony, widely opposed by the opposition, was also given a bath by foreign envoys. The head of state proclaimed zero tolerance to corruption at the ceremony.
Thank you.
South Sudan's President Salva Kiir urged newly appointed governors to support a peace agreement between his government and the opposition signed in late August. Speaking at a swearing-in ceremony Tuesday, the president also said there will be zero tolerance to corruption in his government.
And promote.
We need good governance. Good governance is what we need. And good governance comes with zero tolerance to corruption. Corruption is still a cancer to us in our country. So it is something that you people will have to still continue to fight.
On 24th December, President Kiir issued a decree dissolving the previous 10 states that form South Sudan and created 28 new states, in a move that has since been criticized by the opposition.
No.
Addressing the newly appointed governors, President Kiir said those states were designated for the opposition as per the peace agreement. He urged the governors in those states to cooperate and see to it that the agreement is followed to the letter.
I understand, you know, there are people who are still breathing fire of the damages that happened to their states. And that, you know, they have not accepted this idea of reconciliation. No, you must stand firm to convince them that war is over. Let us implement that.
President Kiir reiterated the government commitments to implement the agreement and directed the governors to receive and protect members of the opposition in their respective states. Earlier on, opposition spokesperson James Gadet said the operationalization of the states will negatively impact the implementation of the agreement. Foreign dignitaries were notably absent in the event.
The KCP mean score of public schools has dropped by 7 points, while that of private schools has increased. Announcing the 2015 KCP results, Education Cabinet Secretary Fred Matiang'i attributed the dismal performance to gross teacher absenteeism in public schools, our reporter explains.
Finally, KCPE candidates who sat for the exams this year have today known their fate. Education Cabinet Secretary Fred Matiang'i announced the release of KCPE results, which revealed a decline in the performance of public schools in KCPE examinations. Matiang'i attributed the poor performance by public schools to teachers' absenteeism, which he says should be dealt with. Education stakeholders have also attributed the dismal performance by public schools to the teacher strike in September.
Our case of teacher absenteeism in Kenya is coming to chronic proportions. So are we surprised that we are seeing a decline in the mean score? So time is here for us to have a candid, very sincere and bare-knuckled conversation one with another.
Two strikes in one calendar year. That one must have had profound effect on the performance. That one is true. But on the issue of teacher absenteeism, it is something which must be diagnosed properly. Why are teachers not going to school?
More than 455,221 candidates scored above the mean score. More than 7,000 candidates scored 400 marks and above in this year's KCPE results. Candidates in Garissa, Wajir and Mandera counties recorded better performance in 2015 despite the shortage of teachers experienced in three counties this year. Female candidates outperformed male candidates in English language and composition and Kiswahili language and Insha. The country also achieved gender parity in education during the national examinations with 49.6% girls and boys 40.4%. Now 23 counties out of the 47 counties had more girls than boys who sat for the KCPE exams.
However, Mandera, Garissa, Turkana, Samburu and Wajir were some of the counties where gender disparity in favor of boys is very high.
We have noticed significant improvement in performance in English composition. We have noticed that in cases for example, English language, mathematics and religious education, there is a slight improvement, especially by the male candidates as compared to the female candidates.
Matiang'i released the results amid concerns over exam malpractice. The Kenya National Examination Council has already identified the people who were responsible for exam malpractices. Cheating was recorded in 111 exam centers out of the 25,127. Only 12 out of the 47 counties did not have even one case of cheating. Results of the affected schools and students have been withheld and respective schools served with letters.
For example, in about 23 of our 47 counties, we registered more girls than boys, and we have pointed this out in Nairobi, Nakuru, Bungoma, Kakamega, Kiambu, Kitui, Machakos, Meru, Kisi, Kericho. A lot of work has got to be done in Samburu to ensure that the achievements we have raised at the national level of gender parity is also reflected in these counties.
Education Cabinet Secretary says the government will do whatever it takes to bring cheating to an end. The Minister of Education is currently carrying out an in-depth audit to determine the root causes of exam malpractice. The auditing will involve auditing all exam processes undertaken this year, from setting of questions to the actual administrations of the examinations.
We want to find a way of dealing with this nonsense on examination cheating once and for all, because we cannot condemn the lives of our children on account of our own irresponsibility. Disaggregate all these results and give each county their results, complete with their figures of irregularities. Of the 2,709 cases, each county to get their cases and pursue their cases and deal with their cases at county level, each county.
To date, a total of 157 persons who include head teachers, deputy head teachers, teachers, university students, candidates, police officers, and parents have been arrested and charged in courts for various offenses committed during the examination.
2,834 adults sat for the KCP exams. Now, the number of underage candidates who sat for the national exams in 2015 decreased from 18,871 to 4,955. Nairobi, Kericho, Murang'a, Bomet and Kuti are some of the counties which had large number underage candidates who sat for the exams. Candidates in the KCP examinations had increased from 880,486 in 2014 to 927,789 in 2015.
The KCPE 2015 examination results have finally been released, and come the 21st of January, the 4-month selection process will start. Now, Cabinet Secretary Fred Matiang'i says that the selection process will be free and fair for all candidates from both public and private schools. Brenda Zeda Radido at Mtiani House, Nairobi. Well, from a distance, the city of Bangui, capital of the Central African Republic, would pass for a heaven on earth, but wade through the waters of River Ubangi. Then the sight that greets you changes everything. Every shores of this river tells rather disturbing tale.
Two and a half years ago, violence tore through Bangui, leading to more than 400,000 refugees to flee the Central African Republic. Well, over 100,000 prefer to settle in the Democratic Republic of Congo, just across the river. The conflict, fueled by competition for scarce resources and bad leadership, saw small fights get bigger and communities get polarized, eventually leading to religious violence. While refugee flow into the DRC has been relatively light in recent months, many Muslims still do not live in the camps. This invokes mistrust in other groups, but the UNHCR and partners have since engaged the leaders of these two sides in a bid to bridge the existing gap through direct meetings between refugee leaders. Dennis Pittin and his family of 10 have seen the better part of the violence since it started. They fled across the river to safety in Congo. They still dream of reconciliation.
C'est nous-mêmes qu'on peut organiser la paix.
The key to peace is in ourselves. If I could learn to get on with the Muslims, then we will have peace. And if the Muslims reached out to me, there would be peace.
Si les musulmans s'attendaient avec moi, ça sera, on va avoir la paix.
While tension remains evident, some members of the two communities are slowly trying to come back together.
It was impossible for us to get on in the beginning. There was so much anger. The Muslims couldn't go to that camp straight away. But we will come together step by step.
That's what Dennis Pittin dreams of, taking his family home, getting back to normal, crossing back over the river.
Guinea has been declared free of Ebola after more than 2,500 people died from the virus in West Africa country. The declaration now leaves Liberia as the only country still waiting a countdown for the end of the epidemic.
Il faut pas toucher une personne.
People in the Guinea capital, Conakry, greeted the declaration by authorities and the UN World Health Organization with mixed emotions. The deaths and damage the virus did to the economy and the country's health and education sectors are still fresh in their minds. Many survivors remember how their loved ones died. Ebola has orphaned about 6,200 children in Guinea, according to the National Coordination Center for the Fight Against Ebola. There were more than 3,800 Ebola cases in Guinea, out of more than 28,600 cases globally, with 11,300 deaths. Almost all the cases and deaths were in Guinea and its neighbors Liberia and Sierra Leone. A country is declared Ebola-free 42 days after the recovery or death of the final patient and if there are no new infections. Merci. Liberia has lost more than 4,800 people to the hemorrhagic fever, but if all goes well, will be declared virus-free in January. Liberia was declared Ebola-free in May and September, but each time new cases emerged. Sierra Leone officially ended its epidemic in November.
Fresh peace talks aimed at averting the Burundian crisis resumed in Kampala on Sunday under the leadership of Ugandan President Yoweri Museveni, backed by the East African Community and the United Nations Security Council. Now, the peace talks are aimed at finding a political solution following months of violence in the capital Bujumbura and other parts of the East African country.
Rival Burundi factions are attending the peace negotiations aimed at ending months of violence, diplomats have confirmed. Those attending the meeting in Uganda's presidential palace are government delegation as well as some opposition members and civil society representatives.
La convocation à cette session trouverait fondement.
It is not clear if participants will discuss a proposal from the African Union Peace and Security Council to deploy up to 5,000 peacekeepers in Burundi to help protect civilians. Certainly, in trying to register apprehension against AU forces deployment, thousands of Burundians demonstrated against AU's proposal through protests led by Vice President Gaston Sindimwo. Sindimwo said Burundi's army is capable of halting violence and protecting Burundians regardless of their political affiliations. Burundi's unrest began in April when President Pierre Nkurunziza announced his intention to run for a controversial third term, which he went on to win in July. At least 400 people have been killed and more than 200,000 displaced since violence erupted in Burundi early this year. The African Union has authorized deployment of 5,000 troops to restore peace. Key issues like stabilizing the security within Burundi will be one of the major agendas during the dialogue. Fears are high that delays in finding the much-needed resolution will plunge the country back to civil war barely a decade after their perilous 12 years of civil war.
APRU has greeted the killing of at least two people in Mandera last night, with the county leaders dismissing claims the two passengers killed were militants. Now, the two were killed by Kenyan Defense Forces after they defied an order to stop.
Hashtag Mandera Killings has been trending on the social media following the killing of at least two people who were riding in a Probox. Most people reacting to this trending topic have castigated the Kenya Defense Forces for killing the two mistakenly.
We need the government to do something about this. Four people have died without a reason. We don't know what's wrong with the government. There's a lot of problem going here, so we need to solve that problem.
Hatujawahi ona vita kama hii, tutawahi ona maisha kama hii. Hata sisi wenyewe tunashindwa kukaa kwa nyumba kila mahali. Tunaogopa usiku na mchana, tafadhali gafam. Sasa tunataka mtusaidie. Sasa kumbukanyengu watu walingetusaidia kama wanaua wengine. Sasa tutaenda wapi?
However, according to Mandera County Commissioner Frederick Shisia, the two defied an order to stop by KDF personnel whom he claimed had detected an explosive in the vehicle. The military personnel shot at the vehicle, killing the two occupants. Victims, however, have a different account of this story.
Sasa tumeingia barabara, nyuma yetu kifaro inakuja tu. Anatufungia bus. Baka wametufanyia kama kichungi. Wawili wamekufa hapo. Mimi naye nikapoteza fahamu kidogo, lakini nilikuwa kawaida tu. Hii ambavu za ile imenipiga, ndio nimesikia zaidi kizunguzungu. Na hii mpili na mocha hapa kicho. Ndio sasa hawa naye wakaenda. Sasa wametumalizia risasi wakaenda.
Mandera County Governor Ali Roba has dismissed claims that the occupants of the Probox had explosives, demanding for a full investigation into the incident. This comes a day after two police officers were shot dead while traveling to Elwak, and barely a week since another contingent was blown by implanted IEDs. Sunday, Mandera leaders led by Governor Ali Roba called on the government to step up security in the county following these latest attacks in the area.
Wawili wamekufa hapo. Mimi naye nikapoteza fahamu kidogo.
Well, that is all we had for you this afternoon on Weekly Report right here on Ebro Africa TV. Enjoy the rest of your afternoon. I've been your host, Brenda Zedere Didou.